website audit, which is something that I am now doing over at the Geek Initiative. For $99 for an hour-long session, I will do this for you as well. So what we're going to do tonight is go through this site here. We're going to evaluate and audit the site for looking at, are things selling? How can we make this better? And how are these blog posts helping or hindering sales? And what can we do with this? Because the blog is a really large component of this particular site. And I don't want to get too much into it because I'm going to ask some leading questions from Catherine, who is our guest today and the owner of this site. So, welcome, Catherine. How are you today? Me too. Me too. I hear you. Nice. Oh my gosh. Wow. Yeah, I'm working on this really long marketing content. It's gonna be this, sign up for my email list to see this content type of thing, a lead magnet. And it's turning out to be more of an ebook, but I've got to cut it off for tonight. Like, I've got to get it out the door so I can use it to get some more business, to get some more books in. So I hear you about that pressure, and with NaNoWriMo coming up, I'm like just putting full force behind behind that now that Chariot's launched. So it's kind of like one thing after the other. But I would love to know all about how you started this business and how you picked the name and kind of how you chose to do the design. And the only other thing I'm going to say first is just to let our viewers know that that we actually met at a live action role playing game at New World Magic Scola. And so we met like pretending to be wizards. we were wizards together, right? We were wizards together. And we did. Right? Right? Yeah, it was weird, and like you would come up in every conversation I had with someone else, and like it was pretty fun. Yeah. Do you think that some of your in real life tendencies to be organized and reliable perhaps bled through a little bit? Because that's what I'm thinking. Because now that I've gotten to know you a bit out of game, and to see how organized you are about all of your activities and your hobbies and your business, that would be my guess. And yeah. And for those listening, part of the reason I'm going through this aspect of the conversation, aside from the fact that I enjoy talking to Catherine and catching up with her, is that it gives me a real insight into how she runs her business and maybe some assets that she has that she isn't utilizing to market her business or to add things to the site. So when I get on a call with a client and I'm, just kind of chit-chatting with them, it's not really just being polite. I'm kind of getting an insight here and I'm imparting some insights that I've observed about Catherine just from kind of interacting with her a lot on Facebook and having played with her at a live action role-playing game, and just having taken stock of some of her strengths. And as we go forward looking at her site, I'm going to use that to provide feedback to her, not only in just knowing what she's capable of, but also in how I deliver the feedback. So I always talk about my friend Alex, who's actually getting married. Catherine just got married. Congratulations, by the way.
I never want to organize a wedding.
You would not be a professional wedding planner.
I really would not. I can think about it one time, but having to deal with flaky vendors is stressful for me.
Yes.
As a vendor myself, like it only makes me angry on like a professional level. Like I can't
Yes.
deal with the personal ones. When I'm like, the woman was supposed to handle our invitations, I had to threaten to find someone else
Oh my gosh.
because I'm on the wedding and she didn't have our stuff. And she actually she forgot about me. And I was just like, "Are you fucking serious, bitch? Like, cool. Like, you better get ready to be ripped a new asshole because this is not cool." And my parting favor for her was to not give her a review.
Nice.
It was a disastrous experience from like she misspelled Herb's last name on
Oh
purpose.
my gosh.
Spell check,
Yeah,
like.
just double check. Come on. Double check. Yeah, yeah.
So, from the business back to that part of the conversation. Back in, I think 2013, I ended up joining a local witchcraft circle in my area. I'd always kind of wanted to get into that. And the store was kind of born out of my personal frustrations with the people in that group. Like they were always very poorly organized, like you could not count on anything. Just fucking the simplest shit to get done would come through. And to make like insult to injury, they were also incredibly snobby and kind of like pretentious about how, well, real witches should fight pop culture and
Ugh,
like
that's
aesthetics.
the worst.
Basically, like I live for like the pop culture shit. I live
Right.
for the aesthetic. Like I have to get into this shit, to look like fucking Joe Average off the street. And it just felt so annoying and insulting to me, this whole attitude of like, well, you have to do this and this and this. And it's like, like, okay, what bills are you paying? Because if I'm not, that means you can dictate that kind of shit.
Exactly. Exactly.
Like my whole, I had a lot of fantasies as a kid of like the magic shop in Harry Potter or in like Final Fantasy games. I felt like I just want to own that store. Like I just want to have that store, freaking, I've been calling it like Wizard Macy's. Like everyone just come into Wizard Macy's and get your wizard shit
That's awesome.
and I think that was the whole idea for it. I had done a couple other small business ventures, almost all of which failed due to what I'm gonna call just some fucking shenanigans caused by other people. And it left me with a lot of skills in terms of how to source things. Like I was involved in the fashion industry over the course of I think three small businesses, also as a like one being my own and the other two being like involved with other people. Like I was in charge of sourcing custom fabric and finding tailors to make stuff for J Fashion designs. And so I just learned a bizarre amount of how to source shit. And I was just kind of frustrated at the lack of goods that I wanted
Yeah, you saw an opening, you saw a lack of something that you needed, and then you went ahead and created it, which is actually a fantastic way to start a business. So you also vend, right? I know you've done local events. Can you tell me about that? Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and I'm assuming a lot of that's like indoor. Yeah. Move up. Yeah. Yeah, they have bathrooms. That's good. I got you. So that's good. So we know a little bit about some of the business strategies you've been employing, and I know originally you'd also asked about some social media engagement. So we're gonna get to that too, as we talk about it. But just knowing a little bit about kind of what you're doing and some of your goals, I'm gonna give you some basic feedback about your site. Obviously, one of your goals is to engage your audience. Another goal is to sell them cool stuff. And I feel like one of your goals, I think I want to say that you are kind of saying you want to make them kind of feel at home, like they're in that Wizard Macy's, right? Is that right? Nice. I love it. I love it. So, that kind of gives me some ideas. Hang on one second. I'm just jotting down a bunch of notes as we're talking. So, I'm gonna do a high level overview of your site and just cover some really big things that I see that you could change or that you're doing right. And so, we'll get more into the blogs themselves later. And I talked to you a bit offline about this already, but your number one asset right here are your blogs. You're a fantastic writer. You have wonderful header images. You feature your products in the header images without making it look too salesy, and you just have a natural storytelling ability when you write. So that's something that a lot of business owners don't have. So we're going to take full advantage of the fact that you don't actually have to buy blogging because you can do that yourself. I work with a lot of people who are paying me, 300 plus bucks a month to do blogging content or looking at other people to do that. And that's a lot of money, and it's honestly like kind of undervaluing what a blogger does, I think. But if you can do it for yourself, that's better. And we're going to jump into a couple blogs and look at them one by one. But overall, your blogs and your strategy are really good. You have a great sense of what to post to pull people in, which is fantastic. So, number one asset, blogs. I'm going to deliver that first because I'm going to get into some criticism and some stuff that you could do that you're not doing. So I'm looking at your menu up on the top. First of all, the featured posts up there, fantastic. Keep them there. Your blog is going to drive things. I would say instead of the three columns, maybe do two columns and then have the third column start to list products and not necessarily only have the shop in a separate section. So consider that for the layout if you can. And then at the top, so you have cart, you have checkout, and you have shop. I don't think you should take out any of those things, but you're going to need to add stuff there because you don't want to make a store as much as you want to make a community. So think about when you go into like your favorite gaming store where you feel comfortable, which I know might be hard as a woman, right? But like you go into the store, you feel kind of at home, like you want to sit down and look around. That's kind of what we want to go for here. And since you already have this really specific idea of being like the Wizard Macy's, like that's perfect. You want to take that and run with it. And part of that is having these images that you already have on your site, but part of that is also laying things out appropriately. So they're there for the community, and you just happen to sell stuff. That's kind of how it works. So I spent 10 years building my personal brand and 6 years building the Geek Initiative, my own online community, and now I'm trying to take that and harness that and sell, content agency services and marketing stuff and and develop live action role playing games and sell tickets. So, what you need to do now is to develop your own community. You don't need to necessarily be only part of a larger community in this niche. You need to really start developing your own community. And you've already got a really good sense of what makes you unique, what makes your stuff different than everyone else. You have a really good personal aesthetic. I could definitely I would definitely advise you to add a social your social component to the site. Like, people want to see you and your aesthetic. You are your brand. Hi there, Combs writes. Thank you for joining us. If you have any questions, just pop them into the chat. I'm doing a live marketing audit of the website that you see on screen, and I have the website and business owner Catherine here on the line with me, so we're just going over that here. So I would say, definitely figure a way. Oh, thank you so much for that follow too. I appreciate that. So, yeah, I would definitely add the social component in, especially the visual aspect of Instagram, because you have a really good aesthetic and your personal aesthetic is part of your overall brand and people want to see that. So definitely add a link to your Instagram and definitely make it visual. And you do such a great job of that on your other platforms. And Combs, I'm gonna give you, oh, sorry about that. I'm gonna give you the URL right here. There we go. All right. So yes, social, adding your social to it is one component. I would almost say maybe do like one, if you're gonna stick with a three column layout, do blogs on one, and then do your Instagram posts on one and post a little more frequently on there, and then do your shop on the other one. So you've got, the content, you've got the social, and then you've got the products. And I think that would be really, really good because you want to make it like a community. You don't need to have like your own forum on there, right? Like, the Geek Initiative doesn't have its own forum on the site, but we have a Discord channel we're growing. We're trying to engage our community where they live, and they're gamers. So yeah. Hey Combs, you don't necessarily have to be pagan to get this. We're talking about like marketing, and I know you're a writer, so we're going to be talking a little bit about blogging for businesses and marketing copy. And I happen to relate to this niche. I'm actually probably one of a good target customer for Catherine's business, which makes me a good expert to consult on this kind of project. However, I could certainly do this for a site that wasn't something I was interested in. I've actually written sites for rock hauling and plumbing and like stuff that I would never buy. There is a skill to it. It's really easy for me because I would use a lot. I would buy a lot of the stuff if I had money. So yeah, but you don't need to understand the subject matter and what she's selling to get it. In fact, your perspective. Exactly. And in fact, as an observer, Combs, being not pagan, your perspective might be really valuable because we want to make sure that we're communicating clearly with what this stuff is about. Because we want this to be newbie friendly too. You want to write a novel, how do I relate? Well, marketing is all about storytelling. So I live storytelling 24/7. I write live action role playing games. I help brands tell their stories, which is exactly what I'm doing right now. And I do copywriting and editing. I'm editing novels, I'm helping authors improve. So it's really one and the same thing. Right? We're always telling a story. And the overall theme here is I'm helping Catherine tell her story. And her story involves the lovely things she posts on Instagram, which are not appearing on the site. The story involves, putting some of that shop material front and center. So getting back to the site, definitely add the social. At the very top, you could actually add a link to the blog itself. And in fact, what you want to do is kind of trick them a little bit into coming to your site for the blog. Because again, your posts are great. You have amazing inbound marketing content, and you almost want to build your community around the blog more than the store, or as much as the store. And is the kitten yowling? Heck and scram. Oh, that's funny. So yeah, like as you're talking about your cat, right? A lot of your target audience is gonna like cats. I need to see the cat on the website, right? I need to see that maybe in the Insta feed, right? So. So yeah, I would definitely say add your cat to your Instagram. People who stream, they often have like their pets as part of the stream. So when the pet comes on, like when my dog Odin comes on, my roommate streams full time, and so she has a lot of viewers. And when my dog like makes a noise or comes onto the stream, everyone's like, "It's Odin the dog," right? So it's like a feature. He's like a feature of the channel. And that's not limited to a live stream, right? Your pets could be a feature of your social media or your blog posts. I mean, heck, you could write about having a familiar, right? And have your cat's face on the front. That would be really cute. So, in addition to those other things that I've suggested, the blog and the social up on the top navigational menu, I would also make an events listing because you're really super on top of your events. And then what you can do is post your past events and your pictures because you do a beautiful table, you have a nice layout, when you're there, post pictures of that. Get people involved. If you're comfortable doing video, do a little bit of that too and post it on there. And then you, of course, want to post your upcoming events and put that on there. And the thing that's going to tie it all together, and this is going to be like, oh, it's a pain in the ass. It's my weak point too. I'm building it right now. Email. You got to get an email list. Yeah, but you can use MailChimp. It's free if you have under 2,000 people on your list. That's what I use. So MailChimp, and then it'll give you a link that you can pop in the top of there. And then what you should do is with all these wonderful blog posts, your call to action, sometimes it's going to be, hey, if you're interested in like your own dream journal, buy one here. But what you could do instead is link to it in the text or put like a picture of the product with a link directly to the product. But your call to action is more often than not going to be for more blog posts about, whatever, sign up to my email list. Because your blog posts are going to bring people to the site. It's a community, right? And we're going to move on to talking about blog posts in a second because I have a lot to say about what you're doing right and how to capitalize on what you're doing. And especially with your organizational skills that are far better than mine, to be honest. We can definitely really hit some goals here. So, I remember you had told me before that you had been blogging and then you let it drop because you got a little bit discouraged. And right.
Zero growth.
Right, so you weren't seeing the growth on the site, and there are different metrics that you can use to measure growth, and it's not necessarily as obvious as you think. I'm going to pause just a second to address a question we have in chat. Holmes is asking, I want to market my future novel. How would I advertise it through a company? Holmes, I am actually working on a very long post. It might actually become an ebook, and I would love to send it to you because that is not a short answer. That is not a short answer at all. But what you can do right now is exactly what I'm telling Catherine to do, which is to really focus on building a community around your novel. And all you need to do that to do to start that is to start something like a Facebook group and get people involved and engaged, and create some content, some blogs about the topic of your novel. So let me know what genre your novel is in, and I can give you some great tips on how to start. But like, let's say you're writing a sci-fi novel, you could blog about other more popular science fiction. You could blog about technology of the future or androids or anything cool like that, and you're building your community even though you're not ready to sell your book. And then when you're ready and you release it, you're gonna have people behind you to support that and buy your book. But if you send me a private message, Combs, because what I'll do is when I'm done my super long blog post, which covers all the things you need to do to market your novel, I'll go ahead and send that to you because I do this for authors specifically. I do this kind of thing for marketing purposes. I do this kind of thing especially for business owners like Catherine who are in a niche that I'm really, passionate about. But I do this for authors as well. And I also do developmental editing, so I can even help you structure your book. So shoot me a message, give me your email, and what I'll do is I'll email you when it's done. So you're saying it's a near future, dirty business, and back seven kind of stuff. Awesome. I work with an author who does something similar, and I can show you her blog and the kind of stuff she blogs about. She really engages her audience well, and we're about to colonize Mars. Well, we need a network because I'm running a live action role playing game that's all about colonizing Mars. So we can definitely do some cross promo. Let's stay in touch. I'm gonna go ahead and follow you and add you as a friend, and we'll stay in touch and talk about that because I've got a lot of ideas for you. And what we could do is actually do something similar where we talk about this on stream, and I'd love to help you out with that. So let's stay in touch. So getting back to Catherine's site. Email marketing. Email marketing is a huge component of this, and I gotta say it's the one that I've neglected in my own businesses, and finding them really held back by it, right? Because I'm spending a lot of time, more time than I should on social media, more time than I should chasing down my follow-ups and keeping track of customers in databases. And I shouldn't have to do any of that. It should be automated because most of it should be coming from email. And especially since you want to do a lot of this online, this business online, the email list is essential. And you can segment your email list, which means if you found somebody at an event, you could make a label that marks them as local. So that way, when you're vending, you want to make sure you hit them with that email because they're likely to come see you. Whereas someone like me, if I'm getting a message from you about you vending, out in the Midwest or something, I'm going to be like, come on, that's a waste of my time. Like, I'm only there once a year for Gen Con, right? So, to Gen Con, are you going to? Oh, that would be great. You'll get it, and your site already looks really professional. I think having a couple updated blog posts will help. So your email list, you can segment as you build it. You're gonna be way better at this than I am because I am not as organized as you are. Some of it is pure will and determination, as you know about running a small business. But I'm sure you know all about that. But you can segment your list so you have like local people. You'll have people who are interested maybe in specific types of products. You can segment it by how they find you. You can segment it by people who have already purchased from you. And there's a whole bunch of stuff you can do there. My business has different different things because it was easier for me to put everything under the Geek Initiative. So I have my main website where people are interested in content. And I'm telling you all about this because you're going to have people who are super interested in your content. And the content brings them to the site. So the main email that goes out to everyone for both your business and mine should be, hey, look at this nifty content. And the call to action should be, thanks for reading this nifty content. To make sure you don't miss the next post, sign up to our email list. Because all of the people, your local people, your online people, they're all going to have that one thing in common, that they like your blog posts. So when I blog about something general, like I keep talking about sci-fi, I have a sci-fi LARP I'm selling tickets to. I have sci-fi content on my website, and I'm trying to market specifically to sci-fi and fantasy authors, and actually to people a lot like Combs here, who's in the chat, about, you know, because I'm really fascinated by that genre, so it makes me like a better editor, a more committed editor and marketer when I'm talking to those types of authors. So if I'm writing a blog post about science fiction, that topic applies to all of those segments. So that's one that I would send to everyone if I was writing a post about sci-fi. It would hit the people that I want that are interested in Chariot LARP. It would hit the people who are generally interested in geeky stuff. And it will also hit the people who are my sci-fi authors. And hopefully it would interest all of them. And I think a lot of your content has the potential to do the same thing. So your emails are going to be more like, read the full post here. So you might send them like the first paragraph and then say read more, and that'll open the site. Great way to get people to do it. And you can sync that up real easy with your social, and we'll talk about social in a second too. So I'm looking at your posts. Your featured posts are great. You have a post about fluorite, so you're talking about a really practical thing where you also are selling these products. I really don't have very much criticism at all with your posts. I am going to open the Dream Journal one and just kind of roll through it and just give something here. And Combs, you'll want to pay attention to this too, because when you are writing blog posts, which you should be doing right now because you want to build that community that's going to be interested in your work, even if you're posting an excerpt or just something about the genre, these tips can help you too. You got to be blogging if you're an author. You have to be. So, tip number one, and this goes for Catherine as well as for Combs and really for anybody, you want consistency more than frequency. So if you're blogging once a week, that's fine, but blog once a week. If you put a post up every Wednesday at 2 p.m. your local time, perfect. It's better to do that than to be inconsistent. Even better if you can do more than one post a week and post something thematic. So I try and stream, what I'm trying to do, I'm not perfect at it, but I try to stream writing on certain days and LARP content on certain days on my streaming channel. So different people are going to come into my channel at different times. They get very different audiences, but they know like, okay, it's Sunday night, Tara's streaming writing related stuff. And here I am streaming, talking about blogging and marketing. So get them used to that schedule and, take advantage of some holidays that are still evergreen. So we have the same pagan holidays every year. So you could write something general.
I'm actually a non-religious witch.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Good too. Awesome. So what I would suggest is do seasonal stuff, because that's going to appeal to everybody, and that'll be something you're comfy writing about. So seasonal stuff is good. Other types of celebrations also good. National Novel Writing Month is coming up. If you're selling journals, right? That's a good way to go. That kind of stuff would be great. So I would say create a content plan. Plan out like a couple months in advance of what you're going to write and publish every like Wednesday. And just kind of have that all planned out. Have a plan for your graphics. You obviously do a great job there. And just bring it all together. And then what you can do is, and I don't know how your site's set up, but my site's set up on WordPress. And so what I do is I use a plugin called CoSchedule. And CoSchedule is one of the only marketing tools that I actually pay for my site, because CoSchedule allows me to not only schedule my post, but to schedule all my social media at the same time. So I write CoSchedule, CoSchedule.com, CoSchedule. It's amazing, and if you're doing more than one thing, it really helps. It's extremely valuable. I think it's like 30 or 40 bucks a month, and it's the only marketing tool where I pay for the full version because it's a necessity. It saves me so much time. And if I look at my hourly rate and think about how much time I'm sinking into scheduling everything manually, it's like a no-brainer that CoSchedule is the way to go. So yeah, CoSchedule is great. It definitely helps. So what that does in WordPress is when you schedule your blog post, you actually can schedule your social media and you can tell it to post at the most optimal time. So you can publish it whenever you want to publish it, but it'll post to your social most optimal time, and you can do like 10 different social media accounts on there, which is great. And it posts to that. So automating your social to a degree is going to be really helpful. Because you also asked about your social media engagement, and that'll help you some. The fact that your content itself is really engaging is what needs to happen. CoSchedule also has recommended guidelines for how much to post and how often. And again, Colmes, this is useful to you because when you start blogging and you start posting about your book, you're going to need to know about how often to post about it and where. And Twitter, for example, you can be a little spammy on Twitter, right? You can post a little more often, especially if you have a lot of followers, or you have a lot of followers who are following a lot of people, they're gonna miss it. Facebook, you can only really hit that like once with a post, and then maybe follow up like a week or two later, depending. But you gotta be careful on Facebook because people will unfollow for that. I spam it over to Google Plus because who's on Google Plus anymore? I don't know, but it indexes really well, so that helps you with your search engine optimization. You would probably do really well on Tumblr if you're posting links to these blogs. I feel like a lot of your target audience lives on Tumblr, lives on Pinterest, lives on Instagram, and so I'd actually advise you to post on a little bit more accounts than I would other people. Most people I'd say you only want to stick to two or three and kind of focus on those, but I think with a tool like CoSchedule and with your organized personality, you could do a really good job on a bunch of those social media accounts. I really think that would be a good area of focus, even if that meant only blogging once per week instead of twice. I think you could do really well on that, especially since you can do like how-tos. Colmes, thank you so much for joining us, and I will get to your private message, and thanks for reaching out and asking questions. I love the first line of your novel, and I look forward to working with you. Have a great night and get some sleep. So posting on social, I'd recommend for you to kind of go a little harder on that than a lot of people. But looking down, I'm just looking at the Dream Journal blog post itself. So your header image is great. Your writing itself is amazing. It's really genuine. You use the keyword journal, dream journal, a few times, really naturally. I don't know if you were like intending to do that, but you're a very natural search engine optimized copywriter, which is fantastic. You want to put that keyword, dream journal, you want to put it in your title, which you've done. You also want to put it in your first paragraph, preferably in your first two sentences. So, what you would do is just put that somehow in your first two sentences there. And then the other thing is, you are going to want to use, I would insert one or two headers in there. So, H2s, if you're in WordPress, it's going to be an H2 so that you can section it out. Google loves organized content, and you're an organized person, so that's a great match. And you have everything tagged appropriately, which is great. I haven't tried to share this on Facebook, but there is a space for a meta description, And you'll want to use that to write a really catchy meta description. Your meta description should also have your keyword in it. So Dream Journal would be in there. Are you using in WordPress? There's a field for it, but are you using WordPress to make your blog? Perfect. Okay. I'm going to give you a really easy answer. You're going to want to get a free plugin called Yoast SEO. It's spelled just like toast, only with a Y instead of a T. Yoast. Yep, Yoast SEO. And it's actually made by a guy. I think he's Dutch. His name is Yoast. I've talked to him on the phone before. He's a cool dude. Yeah, so Yoast SEO will teach you the basics of search engine optimization. And the cool thing about it is it tells you exactly what you need to do. So when it's the meta description is what shows up in the search engine. It's what tells Google what your site's about. And it shows up like when you share it on Facebook and there's like one or two sentences, that's the meta description. Yeah. Right. Yeah, that makes sense. So what I would suggest there, I don't know of any of those specific plugins. I'm sure Etsy has some kind of like WordPress plugin for their e-commerce. You want to still retain your blog as it is. Absolutely, that's perfectly acceptable. And make sure that you have a way to capture or retain the email addresses of your customers on Etsy, because you want to integrate that into your email list, right? So make sure you do that. And if there's any way you can find out about where they found your shop when they do the checkout, that's important, you know, or even when you like follow up with them to make sure they got their item or something, just ask them, like, can I ask how you heard about, you know, the store? Because they'll tell you if they found your blog post, they'll remember, and then you'll know that it's working. You can also use attribution, it's called, where you can see how many people have clicked on a link and purchased. So the free way to do it is bit.ly, bit.ly. It's like HTTP colon backslash backslash bit.ly, bit.ly. And you can make a free account there. And what it does is you'll put a link in. So say, for example, your dream journal, you'd put that blog link in, or you'd create a link to your store in that post in the dream journal, and you could say like dream journal blog post, call it. And then bit.ly will shorten it, and you can pick the name even, so it would just be like bit.ly slash super cool dream journal. And then you could go into Bitly and see how many people click that specific link to your store. So you know what's working, you can figure out what's converting and what kind of blog posts are working. That's a great way to do it, and that's a free way to kind of do attribution. So That's exactly what you do. You want to monetize. You know, make money twice off the same thing. So what I'm doing right now, I'm streaming this. So I'm creating some like marketing collateral for myself by showing what I can do when I advise someone on their website. And I gained a follower to my stream. And I do also get like tips and bits and stuff in Twitch, and then that pays out down the road. So I'm actually, by doing this, I'm making money a few times, right? So we're doing this as a sample so that I have a really cool marketing piece. But if you were a client who I was streaming, I would be making money from you paying me. I would be making money on the stream, and I would be creating a video that I can use later and embed onto my site to sell my services. So anything you can think of that does that, you're using like I'm basically activating three streams of income at once, potentially, with this kind of thing, which is really cool. And what I like to do is when clients agree to be streamed, I give them a discount on their services. So my streamed editing services cost a lot less than me doing it privately. So if they give me permission to stream it, then I stream it, and then I pick up more editing clients, that kind of thing. So anything you can think of is good. If you do want to get into streaming, the creative channel is slowly growing. So you're kind of getting it on the ground floor. But it's kind of also like you don't really have much to lose because in my channel, like I have links right now scrolling through where it says, hey, I do Chariot LARP. Here's the link. Or, learn more about my marketing services, stuff like that. You can do that and put them to your blog posts, put them to your Etsy. And again, you get the videos. So that takes some of the strain that you're feeling out of creating video content and getting low engagement. It takes it away because you don't have to do all that production. You're just sitting on your stream and creating your stuff. So you're making money because you're selling these products. You're making money because you're gaining a slow but long-term growth on your stream. And then you've got the video that you can export to YouTube onto your YouTube channel. And that's, also usable again. Or you could cut it up and use it in a how-to because you actually know how to video edit, unlike me. So you're creating more content there. So anything you can do to create multiple content streams, especially if you want to ditch your or dip your toe into streaming, that's a great way to do it. Let me look at this blog post. So the blog post itself, we talked about creating content more often, sticking with it. It's a long game. Blogging and inbound content is a long game. But you've really got the right idea. I think if you just build a community around your blog and participate in other communities, you're good to go. It's really hard to go into a Facebook community, for example, and say, here's my store, because that's like against the terms, right? But what I do... Exactly. What I do is somebody asks a question maybe about fluorite. And instead of answering them in a comment, you can say, I actually made a blog post about that. Please check it out. And then you link to it. The post that I was talking about with Colmes Writes earlier, they were asking about how to market their book. Frequently asked question from authors. I was investing a lot of time in answering this and giving free advice. And I was like, you know what? That's not the way to do it. I'm going to put everything I know into one document. And I'm going to publish that, and I'm going to collect their email address as payment for this content, and I'm going to get them the information they need, because this friendly, informative content is what they want. So instead of having to go into a whole long thing for Colmes about how to market their book, I'm just going to follow up and send that post. And I constantly use that. People constantly ask, what is a good editing rate? Or they ask... let's see, I just did a post about mistakes authors make in marketing. Like, I have a bunch of business cards from Gen Con from authors. They don't know their email address on it. I have no idea. But, this is a thing that happens. And some of these are really, they're actually recognized names. So I can Google them and find them, but they should still have their email in there. And, exactly. And, totally. So that's one of the mistakes. So when people ask, like, what should I avoid doing or how do I market my book? Right now, I'm giving them that link to my Medium blog post, which at the very end says, if you're interested in a consultation or some editing services, here are my rates. Another thing that you might want to consider, because I know you also do art and you do writing. So I'm assuming you do commissions. Is that right? Yeah.
Like, here's a ridiculous story for you. You'll just be like, how even? I made friends with this LARPer
mm-hmm.
a couple years ago. His name was, we're just going to call him Ron.
Okay.
Ron found out that I do everything, basically. I make custom props. I've done a little bit of finishing weapons. Not mm-hmm. so much. Mm-hmm. I do it all. And he says, all right, well, I need to approach you about a commission. And Ron wanted, I'm just going to remember all You wanted like a custom spellbook cover, like full set of leather armor.
Oof, that's a lot.
All like dyed red, and he wanted a like full set of robes, like hand embroidered, and like a hat and a
Yeah.
coat. And he wanted like all that. He wanted like a cape with a hood too. And I was like, slow down here. What is your budget?
Right. And he was like $100.
No, he said $50.
Oh my God.
I just started laughing hysterically, and I just wrote, get out of here.
Yeah, and
I
it.
wrote, good. And he kept bothering me about it, and I'm like, Ron, how much do you think fabric costs?
Like, that wouldn't even cover the fabric.
He's like, I don't know, like 10 cents a yard? And I laughed so hard.
I wish, right? I wish.
I was just like, no. I've also had people like try to bargain me down on such things, and so really I only offer commissions to friends. That's
Got
all.
it. Got it. And that was gonna be another like piece of advice that I was gonna offer. Whether you do commissions or not, having transparent pricing is really important. And will deter some of that. And it's tough because you wanna make a buck, even if it's a buck, right? But you gotta have that transparent pricing. I mean, I'm competing with people who are like, yeah, I'll edit your novel for 0.00005 cents per word, and I'm like, well, you get what you pay for, but some authors just they're not, and it's gonna be the same across every small business industry. Like, they're gonna complain, and then they're gonna go on wish.com and they're gonna order a different pendant on wish.com, and it's gonna fall apart 2 weeks later, which is totally what happened to me at NWM.
I definitely get in those situations where they say like, well, I can get this for cheaper at Walmart, or they want me to somehow beat Walmart prices. And I just say, I'm not going to. And they
Yeah.
have to follow me around and ask the same question. And sometimes I have to stick her by them. They don't respect me, not as an artisan or as a merchant, but as a person. And so I have to call in other people, tell them to get out.
Yeah, that's tough. I find that I have to do that too. I've got to have like that enforcer, and it's got to be a dude, and unfortunately, like, it sucks. It really sucks. Like, women in business problems, right? Yep, every time, every time. So, like, I would say, yeah, with your blog posts, use some headers with some H2s in there. Do them every week. Your topics are really good. Just make a content plan so that maybe every now and then you're aligning like your content with a season. And let's see, or an event like NaNoWriMo was my example. Email list, I think I covered that. What are your goals for your store, and who specifically is your audience? Like, what is your we in marketing we call it the buyer persona. So make up a fictional character, and you can base it on a real customer, but make up a fictional character that would shop at your store. What is their name? How do they identify gender wise, and what do they buy?
Their name can be Leslie, and they can gender identify with whatever the fuck they want to identify with.
All right.
There. Leslie is, even if they're not interested in witchcraft, maybe they're real into Harry Potter, or maybe they're real into Little Witch Academia anime. Maybe they just want something to jazz up their room, or as a little treat yourself for their magical practice.
Excellent.
And I think my ideal customer would be Leslie is an egomancer.
Oh, I love that term.
What I mean by an egomancer is not just someone who practices like pop culture magic, but someone who
Right.
like geeks as shit.
Right.
I've got a lot of friends who are egomancers who, maybe people make fun of them for using their Sailor Moon wand, but you know what? That gets the fucking job done. That banishes the crap out of shit, and I'm not gonna make fun of the banana moon wand if that's what it does.
So I'm looking up, I just looked up, I Googled, I haven't done real keyword research on it, but I looked up the term geekomancy, and there isn't much there. There's like a book called that. That's it.
kind of a new term by coined by this person named Rune Emerson.
Okay.
I don't know if they're like a big name on kind of the Tumblr Wish community, which is called Wish Learn.
Mm-hmm.
But they are a joy. They have a podcast. You know, he has a podcast. And I like the term better than pop culture pagan.
Mm-hmm. Right, that makes sense. Now, I know you're saying that this is I'm actually looking at this person's Patreon right now. It's pretty cool. So what I'm pointing out here is that you're coming up with and you're hooked into terms that even though you didn't create them, you're hooked into some terms that aren't necessarily really competitive yet on Google. Which means you can kind of get in there early. Like, I started blogging about LARP and shit back in like 2007. So it was really easy for me to rank and to get authority with as an author and just as a top search result. It's a little more competitive now, as you can imagine, with professional marketers working on blockbuster LARP campaigns. But, I mean, look where I am. I'm like hooked into all of those businesses too because I started early and I did that early. With a term like geekomancer or geekomancy, as long as you credit the people who created it, you could really hook into using that term now. And I'm telling you, just I didn't even do any research on it, but just looking at Google, you could own those keywords. Easy. Especially on a WordPress site. Especially, let me see, let me look something up. What is geekomancy? I'm Googling this now and seeing if I'm gonna get okay, so it does have a little info box on the side. But my guess is that in the future it's gonna become a more general term and not just give a product. Based on what you're saying about kind of like the culture surrounding this. There's a real opening for you to take these kinds of terms. So I would come up with a list of terms that maybe you use a lot that other people aren't using, and go ahead and put that in there. Like you're really good about aesthetic, so just like find some words to define them and slip those into your blog posts, or even make a whole blog post about what that is, or a podcast about what that is and why you identify that way. That's really cool. And you can there are tools you can use. The number one that I'm going to recommend, it's called SEMrush. I used to work there. It's just SEMrush.com. You can get a free account there and it's limited, but what you can do is some keyword research, easy keyword research. You can put in your website and it'll tell you what you're ranking for. It'll tell you what you could rank for. It'll tell you who your competitors are. Or you can put in a keyword like geekomancy and it'll tell you exactly how difficult it would be to rank for it. And what you're going to look for is what we call high value, low competition keywords. The value means if you were to buy a Google AdWord or Google Ad, the value is how much that ad would cost you. So that's how we can kind of like value or evaluate these terms. So it's high value, low competition, meaning a lot of people are not trying to rank for it, so that it'll be easier for you to move up. That's kind of a real indicator that's a strong keyword. And a lot of those are going to actually be what we call long tail keywords, which are more than one or two words, they're phrases. So, an example of a long tail keyword for the Geek Initiative is women in geek culture. I'm going hard on ranking for phrases with my organic methods, meaning things like blog post titles. Because it's like wide open. I'm not going to compete with Geek & Sundry. I don't have like all those channels. I wasn't founded with startup money. I'm not Felicia Day, right? So I'm not going to compete with them for those big keywords. But like I've scooped up some more LARP keywords than they have because that's my niche. And so when sites like that look at content producers. Or when bigger shops, maybe, or movie production companies look at jewelry they want to buy, They're looking at who's kind of on the edge of that, and you have a real good sense of subculture, and you need to put those words, insert those words into your copy. And when you're in WordPress and you've installed Yoast, it'll ask you for your focus keyword. And that's what we talked about before. Your focus keyword, you're going to want to have in your blog post title, and then you're going to want to have that in the beginning of your blog post, and then depending on how long it is, you want to put that in there one or two more times. The last thing I'm going to recommend in terms of writing is to do exactly what I described doing with my own business, which is to create what's called a lead magnet. A lead magnet is a long form piece of content or something that's especially valuable that normally you would ask for money for, something like ebook, and it's going to be niche and it's going to be extremely valuable to them content wise. You're not going to ask them for money. You're going to ask them for their email address. A lead magnet, we're talking about Dane. And so a lead magnet, will capture their email address, and that, will kind of help you out there. So, and there are extensions that I'm currently researching, plugins I'm currently researching, where you can just install it in WordPress and they'll have to give their email address and then it delivers the content. And apparently they integrate with MailChimp. So so that's where where you could go with it. So think about long term some content like that. And that should be evergreen. That should be content that you can use for years to come. It shouldn't be something about like if you're talking about movies, you wouldn't want to talk about like recent stuff. You want like a seasonal thing would be cool. You could even do like four different lead magnets and make one for each season. That would be neat. You could pick like an aesthetic for each season. Stuff like that. And the other place I was thinking of, I can't remember the name of it. There's like a website. It's a fashion website. And you can put together, I'm sure you've been on it. I use it on Tumblr all the time. You can put together different outfits based upon like what's in their database and publish it as yes, Polyvore, right. Use Polyvore not just as another way to bring people to your site, but you can put stuff together on Polyvore, for your whole aesthetic and blog about that. Like you're so good on that aesthetic front, I'm like amazed at it. So totally think about doing that. And I'll take a look at some keywords that you could potentially rank for. But blog weekly, make it a community, grow your email list, which is a real pain in the butt, and I can pass along my knowledge as I go. It's definitely my weak point too here. And you already got your I saw you already added your Instagram and your events, so you got that going. That's great. And like just really start thinking about what you can do to build a community around this. And the other thing I want to suggest, and I think this is like the last big suggestion I have, you're really good at writing stories too. And like I said, marketing is like storytelling. It's one and the same. I do marketing all the time, or I do storytelling all the time, because in one way or another, I'm always telling stories. You kind of have a similar potential. And I'm even thinking with fiction, you kind of have a potential there too. So, give away a story, that's a lead magnet. Because people are paying you for stories on Patreon already. If you did a different type of story that related to your store and asked for the email address in exchange for the story, you already know that your stories are worth money. So maybe they're worth an email address too. That's another thing you could use to capture email addresses or to send to people or to blog and send out. I think people would really appreciate that too. And they'd like a behind the scenes look. They want to know about. You don't really have an about page. They want to know about you. Your Instagram is going to help tell that story, keep posting some selfies, but they also want to know about you because like I don't think I sell tickets to Chariot LARP only because people think the LARP is cool. They're buying the tickets because they've been wanting to play a LARP that I create. They've been waiting for me to do something. They want to know more about my story. They want to know what kind of stories I can create with them. And they're supporting me. And you're going to have the same thing because you've got a lot of fans and friends that support you. So you're already on your way to building that community. And having a little behind the scenes look here and there will help. If you stream again, capturing that video, capturing that progress on Instagram, that's also telling your story. But you need like an about page that talks about who you are. And that can help too. And I think that's really the last page I'd recommend adding. So I know that was a lot. Do you have any other questions? Absolutely, absolutely. We have had several viewers over the course of our chat, and I do want to thank them for participating, especially Colmes writes for asking some great marketing questions in there and really getting me to talk about storytelling and how marketing a book and marketing your website and your business are in some ways really similar because it is really all about storytelling, and that's kind of what ties it all together. Yeah. Yo, that sounds right up her alley, right? Yeah, Minerva would bust that up so hard. It's so true. It's so true. It's so true. She's always after shady people. What are you doing? She ignores some of the shady people, specifically the Dubois. Like the stuff that Quintana and Bellwether got away with, come on now. She just like turned a blind eye to them because she liked them. But yeah. Minerva was totally in like she Tara noticed some. Minerva did not. She liked him too much. She didn't notice. She was oblivious to the ends. Which has led me to think of some very interesting adventures for her to do in the world of being a marshal. Like I really wonder like what who she'll kind of look the other way for. And I think a lot of them are Dubois. like she would still look the other way if Reese was shady. She's still right. Yeah. She sends Nice. That's what I used for Minerva's scar that like horrified everybody, so cool. So, I'm gonna wrap it up. Hit me up on Facebook if you have more questions. And for anybody watching this, you can always email me at tgicontentservices@gmail.com and I will talk marketing with you there. You can also reach out to me here on Twitch. Just send me a private message and we will chat. And thank you so much, Catherine, for I almost called you Lilith. I almost called you Lilith. We got into talking LARP. We got into talking LARP. No, you're not actually Lilith. Yes, thank you so much for letting us evaluate your site. You're so on the ball. You're already making changes. That warms my marketing heart. And let me know if you have any other questions. Good. If only everyone had a planner. Awesome. I have every faith in your organizational capabilities, and good luck, and reach out if you need anything. And thanks again so much for letting us do this. And everybody, I'm going to, for everyone in the chat, I'm going to post in the link again to her store. Go check it out. And buy her stuff. And once she gets her email list up, subscribe. Cool. So, thanks again, and I will talk to you soon. Bye.